good evening, everyone. And thank you all so much for being here tonight. I'm Joanne Campbell, principal here at ABRHS, and it's my absolute pleasure to welcome you to an evening with Nancy Frates. When I saw the title of her presentation, The Ice Bucket Challenge, A Story of Family and Community Strength, I was inspired all over again by the way she and her family have faced her son Pete's illness with grace, love, and hope. Through the vehicle of social media, many of us have had the privilege of sharing in Pete's journey, in learning from his strength, and in seeing what incredible power results when we come together in love to raise awareness about a cause that is close to our hearts. We are so grateful to the PTSO, Danny's Place Youth Services, and the AB United Way for making tonight possible. At the conclusion of the presentation, you will get to see a few AB staff members, including administrators and principals, take the Ice Bucket Challenge. I sort of feel like I need to give a disclaimer. I had planned to be one of those people, but I have a cold and I thought maybe it wouldn't be a great idea to do that. So instead, I will share with you a video of my then 2.5-year-old son and I doing the Ice Bucket Challenge in 2014. It's a much blonder time, you'll see that in the video, much blonder. In at my place tonight, however, perhaps even more meaningful, is one of our veteran staff members and our high school registrar, Ms. Jane Link. Jane, can you just stand for a minute? Do you mind standing? Jane lost her husband to ALS in 1972. She's grateful for the awareness being raised 44 years after her father's death, and we are grateful for her willingness to participate tonight. Thank you, Jane. Thank you again for being here. Hello again for being here, and it is now my pleasure to introduce our PTSO Forums Chair, Susan Lerner.
Thank you, Joanne. Good evening. The PTSO Danny's Place Youth Services and AV United Way have developed a wonderful partnership over the past few years. While each organization has a different mission, we share a commonality of supporting Acton Boxborough youth. It's been an absolute pleasure to work with Cindy McCarthy from Danny's Place and Lisa St. Armand and Ibit Spears of the AV United Way Board of Directors. For those of you who have joined the PTSO, donated to Danny's Place and AV United Way, we thank you for supporting the work we do in the community. Because of your generosity, we're able to sponsor our speaker series. I'd like to take a moment to speak about our organizations. The mission of Danny's Place Youth Services is to empower youth through life and leadership skills. When a young person is empowered, they will feel better about themselves and will feel more successful in life. Through generous donations from the community, the Acton Boxborough United Way supports residents at every stage of life, from therapeutic services for the toddler who has a speech delay, to a meal delivered to an elderly housebound resident, to sponsoring programs such as this one tonight. Last year, AB United Way invested in a comprehensive needs assessment, results of which are available on the ABUW website. As part of that project, AB United Way conducted a community survey that many of you filled out. This survey revealed that stress is a major concern across all ages, but particularly for teens and young adults. The purpose of the AB Regional PTSO is to improve, provide, and maintain communication among parents, faculty, students, administrators, school committee, and community members, and to provide a framework for promoting excellence at the junior high and high school. Another goal is to provide educational and informational programs such as tonight's event. On behalf of our organizations, I'd like to thank Joanne Campbell, Beth Baker, and Andrew Shen for their ongoing commitment to promoting the overall well-being of our students, as well as participating in the Ice Bucket Challenge at the end of tonight's presentation. I'd also like to invite everyone to enjoy the dessert reception featuring desserts by Bistro Sweets Confections and sponsored by Metro West Behavioral Health Center in Acton. And now, I'd like to introduce our speaker. In 2011, Nancy Frates' 27-year-old son, Peter, was diagnosed with ALS. The family's world changed in a moment. They were told there was no treatment or cure and that life expectancy was 2 to 5 years. Since that day, Nancy has immersed herself in the ALS community. In 2014, Pete, along with family and supporters, inspired the ALS Ice Bucket Challenge to go viral, raising $220 million to date for the ALS Association and global partners. This funding has allowed ALS researchers to make progress in understanding this fatal disease. Nancy is the CEO of Team Freight Train and a member of the ALS Association National Board of Trustees. Please join me in welcoming Nancy Frates.
Hello. Good evening. Thank you all for coming. I'm going to start the presentation with a little introduction.
You have almost definitely heard of the Ice Bucket Challenge, a viral sensation that caught the internet by storm, raising more than $115 million to help find a cure for ALS. But you may not have heard of Pete Frates. And although the viral craze may have calmed, the fight for a cure continues at a place Pete and his family call Ground Zero. On America's David Spindle tells us more about the fourth annual plunge for Pete.
This is Peter Frates. A Massachusetts resident, Pete excelled in several sports growing up, eventually going on to play baseball at Boston College.
I'd have been one particular moment was probably my junior at PC in the home run at Fenway Park.
But now his legacy goes way beyond the diamond. In 2012, Pete was diagnosed with ALS, also known as Lou Gehrig's disease. The National Institute of Health describes ALS as a rapidly progressive and fatal neurological disease that attacks the nerve cells that control muscle movement. But to those who bear the burden of this illness, it is so much more. What often starts with muscle twitching and weakness in an arm or leg eventually takes over your ability to move, speak, eat, and even breathe, all while your brain never misses a beat.
ALS drastically affects your physical being, but inside I'm as sharp as ever, if not sharper than I've ever been.
But Pete, the baseball star, wasn't taking his diagnosis without a couple swings. He started a fund for research to strike out ALS, speaking at schools and even the FDA in Washington. Then came the home run idea. Pete, along with a friend who also has the disease, launched the Ice Bucket Challenge. They challenged several others to build awareness and raise money for ALS. And the movement went viral.
ALS and my friend, Pete Frates.
Thousands across the globe, celebrities and supporters alike, dumped water on their heads and challenged their friends to do the same, or to donate to help find a cure.
That was really cool.
Thousands of buckets of ice cold water, millions of dollars raised, and a priceless amount of awareness later, the fight against ALS continues here at Good Harbor Beach in Gloucester, Massachusetts. Long before the Ice Bucket Challenge, the local stardom, and the segments on SportsCenter, there was the plunge for Pete. And here at the fourth annual event, hundreds dress up in costume and brave freezing cold water to keep pressing for a cure. And their efforts are appreciated by the Frates family and their support group, Team Freight Train.
You're looking at Ground Zero Pete's Network.
By the thousands that are diagnosed with ALS every year.
When I have my symptoms, I feel alone. And to be here and see all this, it's amazing.
As well as the supporters who come back year after year, hoping to make a difference.
We'll be here every year plunging.
We're gonna continue this fight, and whether we continue to dump ice on our heads or jump in the Atlantic Ocean in December, we're gonna keep going.
A reminder that the journey for a cure, like all journeys, starts with a single icy step. News.
Well, thank you for having me here. I like to start my presentation so that you can see Pete. I'm a little taken back because when I see him speaking, Pete lost his ability to speak about 2 years ago, so that video was over 2 years ago. So what I first like to do is just give you a little background about ALS. ALS is a brain disease, and what it affects is the motor neurons. The motor neurons are the electrical current that when your brain tells the muscle, it's through the motor neuron that it tells the muscle to lift your arm. Unfortunately, that electrical current, the motor neuron, is what is attacked by negative proteins and other many other complicated things. So the actual muscles in the ALS patient are really truly never affected, other than the fact they atrophy as the electric current from non-use. So there's two types of ALS. ALS starts either in the lumbar region, which is the bottom part of the spine, which is where Pete started. And what that does, it affects the extremities first and then moves up the spine to the bulbar. And the bulbar part is where, when they lose the ability to speak, to eat, and eventually to breathe. Every 90 minutes, someone in the country is diagnosed with ALS. Every 90 minutes, someone dies from ALS. The prognosis is 2 to 5 years, and that's when it will hit the respiratory area. After Pete was diagnosed, about 2 weeks after Pete was diagnosed, we were told that when he progressed in this disease, that it was going to cost us about $250,000 a year to take care of him. And we are at that point now with Pete. So let's talk about our story. So my husband and I, we're going back to the 70s. We were at Boston College. We graduated, we got married, and we had 3 great kids. Our oldest, Jennifer, who's with me tonight, went to Boston College, got a job with Goldman Sachs, and moved to Manhattan. Our youngest guy, Andrew, he graduated Bentley University in 2012. He moved out and moved to Charlestown. And our middle guy, Pete. Pete went to St. John's Prep. He was a 4-year athlete in football, hockey, and baseball. And in his senior year, he decided that he was gonna pursue baseball, even though he was being recruited for all 3 sports. And happily, he went to our alma mater, Boston College, where he played on the baseball team for 4 years. And in the senior year, he captained the team. After Pete graduated, unfortunately, Major League Baseball didn't come a calling. So he ended up going to Germany to play professionally. He moved out of the house and went to South Boston. So there we were. We worked really hard for a lot of years. When Andrew graduated Bentley, we high-fived each other. We had 2 living in Boston, 1 living in Manhattan, and we were working for retirement. And in August of 2011, I said to my husband, well, let's get these kids and rally them around one more time before they all get married and have kids and have their own lives. So in August of 2011, when this picture was taken, Jen and her husband Dan came home from New York, and there's Pete on the end and Andrew, and we were all in Florida. And one night, I was sitting around with Pete. And Pete looked at me, and he had gotten a job in the insurance industry when he came back from Germany. And he was living in South Boston, living a great life. But he looked at me and he said, Mom, I'm not so sure this is what I'm supposed to be doing. He said, I feel like I'm not living up to my potential. I'm just really not passionate being in the corporate world. I think I should be doing something else. What do you say when your kid, when he says that to you? He was 26 at the time, and I said, Pete, do where your heart leads. You've got to go where you think you have to go. And then he turned to me and he said, well, Mom, speaking of going, I have to leave the vacation. Because Pete was playing in the Intercity League for the Lexington Blue Sox, and they were in the championship series. He said, I gotta leave the family vacation because I've gotta go home. My teammates are counting on me being there because we're in the championship. I said, go ahead, Pete, go right ahead. He went home and a couple of days later we followed and we were at the championship game right here in Lexington. And Pete was up at the bat. Now the year before in the Intercity League, Pete was batting over 400. He was MVP of not only his team, but of the whole league in 2010. In 2011, Pete was barely hitting 200. He was breaking bats all over the place. And he was up at bat in this championship game, and a fastball came in, which usually he'd hit out of the park. Instead, the ball hit him in the wrist. His wrist went completely limp, came over to the side, and of course his mommy went running over, and he said, don't worry about it, Mom. I've got a doctor. I'm gonna go see a doctor, and he's gonna take care of it. Okay, Pete. So for the next 6 months, Pete was living in Southie, and he took himself to the doctors, and he ended up in a neurologist. And on March 13th, 2012, he said to my husband and I have a doctor who knows what's wrong with my wrist. Can you come with me to the doctors? Sure, we want to know what's going on here. That thing hasn't healed, Pete. What is going on here? So we went in to Beth Israel, to the neurologist's office, sat in the room, the door opened up, and four doctors walked in. That was clue number one, that I wasn't gonna hear he had a sprained wrist. The doctor sat down, looked straight at Pete, and said, so Pete, we've run a battery of tests. You don't have an infection. You don't have a sprain. You don't have a fracture. And when I reflect on that moment, the visual of his hand going up a ladder, getting progressively worse. You don't have Lyme disease. You don't have lupus. You don't have MS. And my brain is, all I kept thinking to myself is, where is he going with this? And then he put his hands on his knees, looked straight at my 27-year-old kid, and said, Pete, I don't know how to tell you this. You have ALS. ALS. So you know when someone says a subject to you, I call it your knowledge Rolodex, you immediately, you know, something out of the air. And my brain started going, okay, ALS, what do I know about ALS? And honestly, it is that moment that has driven me for the last 4 years. Because guess what? I knew two things about ALS. I knew it was bad. I think we all probably knew it was bad prior to August of 2014. But don't ask me what bad meant, because I didn't know what the context of bad was. And of course, we're a baseball family. So I knew Lou Gehrig, in his infamous speech, had been about 75 years ago. So quickly, we turned to the doctor. And my husband and I looked straight out and said, okay, he has ALS. What do we do? Where's the treatment? What's the, you know, what's the cure? Where do we go from here? And then the second shoe dropped, and the doctor looked at us and said, Mr. and Mrs. Freedies, I'm sorry to say we have made no progress in the fight against this disease. There's no treatment, there's no cure, and the prognosis is 2 to 5 years. 2 to 5 years. He's 27 years old. And then he said, do you understand what's gonna happen over that 2 to 5 years? And then he proceeded to tell me how this disease was gonna rob my son of all his muscles during that course of 2 to 5 years. Then he said, don't come back for 3 months. Don't come back for 3 months. You just told me that my son has 2 to 5 years to live and there's nothing you can do about it to stop this. And you don't want me to come back for 3 months. And he said, we have nothing that we can help him with. But in 3 months, come back and we'll check his reflexes and we'll see how his hands are operating and we'll just mark his progress. So we left. Unfortunately, I had to call New York and tell Jen and Dan that this was just what we were handed. So they came home from New York. Andrew came home from his job in Boston. And Pete went and picked his then girlfriend up, Julie, and brought her home. And 6 hours after diagnosis, we were sitting around our kitchen table. And we had small chat. Nobody really knew what to say. We were all still in trauma. And then our leader, Pete, spoke. And the first thing he said, and it was just like he was talking to his teammates, he said, "All right, people, there'll be no whining. I don't want anybody whining about this." He said, "We're not going to look backward. We're going to look forward. The situation that we find ourselves in is completely unacceptable. What an opportunity we've been given to change the world. I'm going to get this disease in front of philanthropists such as Bill Gates. And my other thing that I'm going to do is I'm going to get Major League Baseball. They should be taking ownership of this disease. I'm going to get them to do that." And I think we all just sat around and looked at him in complete awe and just thought to ourselves, he's the strongest person I know and the bravest person I know, because I barely could get myself up off the floor. And here he is telling us, get to work. This is Pete's video that he did 24 hours after diagnosis.
"Hi, everybody. Thanks for checking out the website. For those of you who don't know me, my name is Pete Frates. I'm 27, and I was recently diagnosed with ALS, or as it's more commonly known, Lou Gehrig's disease. I just wanted to check in and let everyone know we'll be using this website as a discussion forum, creating awareness for the disease, fundraising, and also to let people know what's upcoming on the calendar. So I just want to say thank you to everyone who's reached out thus far. Texts, emails, phone calls, handwritten notes. The outpouring of support has been tremendous, and I can't thank everyone enough. So check back in with the website as I'll be blogging as much as possible, and hopefully we'll be talking with everyone real soon. Thanks again."
That's the attitude Pete brought to this diagnosis from the second he was told. He educated himself and learned that this was a disease that needed a leader, that needed someone that would go out and document the day-to-day, because he knew that most people didn't understand what ALS does to its patients. So we got to work, and we created Team Freight Train. This is our first logo, and this is our second logo. And then we sat around within a week, and we looked at, what do we have? What can we do? We had the power of we. We had a leader, Pete, who had a vision that we're going to change the trajectory of this disease. We had a mission. We knew that we needed to tell our story. We knew that ALS was not in the public consciousness, that people didn't understand what this disease was, that it wasn't a top-of-mind disease that most people had. We knew our story was compelling, and we knew if we told the story, people would open their hearts to our story. We had passion. We had talent. When we looked around, we had a whole board of directors. We had an organization right within our family. We had my brother-in-law, Dave, who was a webmaster, who said, "I'm going to create a website for Pete." We had my brother-in-law, Artie, who was an accountant, who said, "I'll take over a trust fund for Pete." We had my sister, Dana, who's a graphic artist, who said, "I'll help create logos." And Team Freight Train was created with that talent. We had treasure, the power of our treasure. And this is where I think is the most important piece of Team Freight Train. You see, Pete was a leader his whole life. I remember kindergarten teachers telling me that other kids would wait for him to show up to see if they were going to play Legos or go into story time. He was always the captain of the team. He was always the mentor that the coach would pick to mentor younger people. And that's because Pete was a natural leader. Now, some leaders lead with intimidation and a lot of talk. Pete always led with kindness and by example and inclusion. Since Pete's diagnosis, we've been the beneficiaries of so many stories of people telling us how Pete had affected their kids' lives. If it was on the football team in Pop Warner, or the hockey rink in Pee Wee Hockey, or on the baseball field in Little League. That he was always including everybody and always motivating all the time. So when Pete gets this diagnosis, we call them the circles of Pete. Boston College, St. John's Prep, Pop Warner, youth hockey, AAU hockey, all these different teams that he played on, never mind all his classmates and coworkers, they all came back. They all came back and stood by him and said, "We're in this fight with you." We had inspiration. We had Pete, because none of us got the diagnosis of ALS. Only Pete got the diagnosis of ALS. And when he said, "I'm gonna document my journey," that meant that he was gonna put himself out there so that people could see the day-to-day of what this disease does to its patients. Anywhere we went, we had a very simple agenda. We just wanted to save our son. So we would get in there and talk to whoever we could. We had been business people our whole lives, so we knew we had to get to know the players. We knew that we had to immerse ourselves in the ALS community, either it be the researchers or the doctors, the fundraisers, anyone who was associated with ALS. We wanted to know them. We wanted them to know us. And we wanted to know how we fit and how we could help this community move the trajectory of the disease. We had our toolkit. So the story is, the day after Pete got diagnosed, my husband and I woke up, and of course we both thought it was a nightmare. And when we realized that it wasn't, we turned to each other and the first thing we thought of was, well, we're gonna go back to medical school. If they can't figure it out, we're gonna go figure it out. And we realized that wasn't where our skill set was. That wasn't our toolkit. We had been entrepreneurs our whole life, and we knew we could brand. So in conjunction with all these other things, we knew that awareness was our lane. We knew we were just going to tell the story and let people understand what this disease was. You see, only 3% of ALS patients are under the age of 30. So to see a young man in the prime of his life, a Division I athlete, be knocked down by this disease, we knew was compelling. And mentoring. When Pete got diagnosed, he reached out immediately to a young man in New Orleans whose name is Steve Gleason. Steve Gleason was a New Orleans Saints football player who at 36 was diagnosed with ALS. He was almost diagnosed 1 year to the day before Pete. 1 year to the day after Pete was diagnosed, a young man named Pat Quinn reached out through email, who lives in New York. He was a 29-year-old who found Pete on the website and said, "That's me." Reached out to Pete and came up, met him, and Pete was mentoring Pat Quinn. This story is based in teammates. Teammates either in work, in school, on the field, on the stage, wherever it may be. Teammates supporting each other. Pete was a leader. Good leaders make everyone around them. They may not be the best player on the team, but they make everyone around them want to do their best. And that's what happened with Pete. He instilled work ethic in everyone, and especially us. He told us, get to work. So we did. We had freight train gear. We had signature events. We would talk to anyone that would listen. And then we would show up at events. This is our first team freight train at our first ALS walk, where we had 125 people walking and raised $30,000 in our first year for the ALS Association. We would ride bikes for ALS TDI. This group rode 200, and every year does this in June, they rode 270 miles over 3 days to raise money for ALS research. And we run. This is a 5K, and this is Team Freight Train at the Harpoon 5K for ALS. But we always show up with positive energy, we always have fun, and we always inspire. And during the next 2.5 years, that's what we did. We just kept plugging away, staying in our lane, raising awareness. And unfortunately, the disease continued to affect Pete. So the first milestone, as we call them in ALS, was that Pete lost his ability to walk. Here's Pete in his motorized wheelchair on the day it was delivered. Now Pete could not just have any motorized wheelchair. He had to call the painter who did Tukaresk's mask and have him customize his wheelchair. But this is how Pete would handle these milestones. I'm gonna show you Pete's Twitter feed after he got his wheelchair. This is what he posted on Twitter. Pete continued to live and continues to this day to live. Pete was an avid boater before he got ALS. This is Pete this past summer. His friends figured out how to rig a pulley system to get him out on the boat. And if you don't follow Pete on Twitter, you probably should. He's at PeteFrades3. He wrote, "Any other ALS patients get their trach suctioned at 35 knots this weekend? Hashtag naughty ALS." So Pete lives every day. And over the, like I said, over the next 2.5 years, that's what he did. And then on July 4th, 2014, Major League Baseball finally came a calling. It was the 75th anniversary of Lou Gehrig's famous speech at Yankee Stadium. And Major League Baseball asked Pete to write a firsthand account of his journey on their blog, which is the Bleacher Report. On July 2nd, 2014, there's an amazing blog that was written by Pete. And the most amazing piece of it is that Pete wrote it with his eyes. Because by July 2nd, 2014, not only had Pete lost the ability to walk, he had lost the ability to use his hands, to eat, he was on a feeding tube, and he had lost his voice. So he now communicates with us with eye gazer technology on a surface, and he writes with his eyes. Pretty amazing. Well, that was July 2nd, 2014. 20 days later, this happened.
All right, we're back now in the social square for the very latest on the viral phenomenon. It's going crazy in everybody's Facebook feeds. It's called the Ice Bucket Challenge, if you haven't heard of it. You pour a bucket of ice cold water over your head for charity. So what actually inspired it all in the first place? Take a look. It's the icy wake-up call flooding the country. The Kennedys joining notables like Justin Timberlake, Martha Stewart, New Jersey Governor Chris Christie even joining in, and Canadian hockey player Paul Bissonnette soaked in bone-chilling glacier water.
social media users accepting the Ice Bucket Challenge, dumping ice water on your head, and daring others to do the same, or donate to ALS Research instead, helping to raise at least $4 million in just the past 2 weeks alone.
We've seen probably a 10x increase in donations, but it's more about awareness.
ALS, also known as Lou Gehrig's disease, impacts the brain and spinal cord, causing progressive paralysis. Pete Brady's was diagnosed in 2012. It robbed the former Boston College baseball captain of his ability to walk and talk. It was his idea, though, along with fellow ALS patient Pat Quinn, to start the challenge.
It's really beyond anything we could have imagined.
His wife Julie says the campaign is a game changer.
Before this, you know, so many people just did not understand what ALS was. We need people to rally around this cause, and people will keep pouring buckets of ice over their head, and so be it.
It's great, it's bringing so much attention to ALS.
It sure.
So, that was 2 weeks when they're reporting 4 million. And you all know, because I'm sure, your neighbors, your friends, people on the beach, anywhere you went during August 2014, you saw the ALS Ice Bucket Challenge. So let's kind of talk a little stats, because during that time, we had a lot of naysayers, people who were saying, oh, that's just a fad. So the first slide I'm going to show you is about awareness, because we knew that if we raised awareness, people would open their hearts. Facebook, who called us in to their office because they wanted to give us these stats face to face, 17 million unique Ice Bucket Challenge, ALS Ice Bucket Challenge videos were posted on Facebook, viewed by 440 million unique viewers over 10 billion times. When we visited Facebook, I said to one of the executives we were meeting with, and when I say executives, everybody but Mark Zuckerberg in the top 10 people at Facebook were in the room with the Quinns and the Fradys to tell us these stats. And I remember saying to them, I know what it was like in my house. I can't imagine. What was it like here at Facebook? And he said, jaw-dropping. He goes, some of the, you know, the analytical guys that really get into numbers, like, wouldn't go home because they were watching it all night long. As you can see on the right there, Twitter, it shows the spike in hashtag ALS Ice Bucket Challenge, hashtag Ice Bucket Challenge. And on the bottom is the YouTube. Over 150 countries posted ALS Ice Bucket Challenge during the month of August of 2014. Now, I don't know about you, but does anybody know how many countries there are? I heard 150 countries, I thought, well, that's pretty good. There's only 196 countries. So, I don't know where the other 46 countries, where they were under a rock, but we're gonna get them next time around for sure. But you can see that the blue is the beginning of the month. The blue is the United States, and the red is international. So as the month went on, the movement spread across the country. So we knew if we stayed in the lane of awareness, we hoped people would learn about the disease. So did people learn about the disease? On the right is Wikipedia facts. On an average month, between January of 2014 and July 2014, the ALS page in Wikipedia was hit on an average of about 164,000 times. During the month of August 2014, the ALS page on Wikipedia was hit 3 million times. People obviously went and wanted to understand what this disease was that they were pouring cold water over their head about. On the right, that's Google search 2014 statistics. And the one, you can read what they all are, but the one that I find most compelling is the second to the bottom. How many of us go to Google and just type in, what is whatever you're curious about? What is this? What is that? What is ALS was the number one searched what is topic on Google in 2014. Now let's put that into context. The Ice Bucket Challenge didn't start till August 1st of 2014. All the other topics had a 7-month running start on us, and we were still the number one topic. So they opened their hearts, they educated, and then we hoped that they would open their wallets. And you did. You opened your wallets to our cause, and we're so forever grateful for it. Worldwide, the ALS Ice Bucket Challenge raised $250 million. The ALS Association of the United States raised 115 of that $250 million. They received donations from 2.4 million new donors. Of that 2.4 million, 40% of those people checked the little box that said they wanted to stay engaged with our cause. 1 million new committed donors to our cause. And the last stat, this is the disruption in philanthropy. This is good news for everybody. 55% of ALSA's United States donations came from 18 to 30 year olds. That means that this demographic dipped their toes in the waters of philanthropy, and they now will grow. As they grow, their incomes grow, and their commitments grow. So it's good news for all nonprofits. Now, when Pete went back for that 3-month checkup back during diagnosis, we went to the top doctor in ALS, who just happens to be at Mass General in Boston. And after she confirmed the diagnosis and did all her stats on Pete's progression, we got up to leave. Pete turned around and looked at her, and he said, "Dr. Merritt, I have one question for you. How much do you need to cure this disease?" And she looked right at him and she said, "Pete, I need $1 billion. And I remember, and he said, "I'm going to get that for you." And I remember my husband and I looking at each other going, "That's impossible. How is he ever going to raise $1 billion? Well, guess what? He's a quarter of the way there. And we will be helping him reach that $1 billion goal in his finish line. And what that proves is that when you think something is impossible, the difference between the impossible and the possible lies in a person's determination," said by a great baseball man, Tommy Lasorda. So how did this whole thing happen, right? We all know it happened. We all know that people were pouring ice over their head. As I said, Pete and Pat had met right after Pat was diagnosed. Pat came up to Boston and met with Pete, and Pat was hadn't told very many people that he had been given this diagnosis of ALS. And Pete said to him, "Pat, how did you find me?" "Well, I went on the internet and I found Team Freight Train." And he said, "Pat, I want you to go back to New York and I want you to do the same thing. All the people that are in your lives, all the circles of Pat, I want you to rally them. I want you to tell them all that this is what you have and that you want them to join you in this fight." So Pat went home in 2013 and created Quinn for the Win in Yonkers, New York. So you have Pete in Boston with Team Freight Train. You have Pat in New York in Westchester County with Quinn for the Win. Steve Gleason, Pete's mentor, is down in New Orleans with Team Gleason. And these young guns of ALS, I call them the young guns because they were young men that were not going to let this define who they were. They were going to define that disease to be their disease. And there were a couple of others in different parts of the country who were doing the same thing. And they knew they were building momentum. Now, the Ice Bucket Challenge had been around for about a year prior to August 2014 for different causes. And it made its way into the golfer circuit down in the South. And a golfer in Florida had a cousin in New York who had ALS. So when it got to him, he poured ice water over his head, and he filmed himself, and he emailed it to his cousin up in New York. Now, his cousin in New York had been had ALS and was in his 13th year of ALS. So his wife went out on her porch, poured ice water over her head, filmed herself, and said, I'm doing this for ALS, and I'm going to name these three people. And she named three people and said, I want you to do the Ice Bucket Challenge for ALS too. And she put it on her Facebook feed. Well, Jeanette Sinertia happens to live in the town next to Pat Quinn. And those three people, one of them was a mutual friend. So when she tagged her in the post, it went on her friend's news feed. And because her friend was a friend of Pat Quinn, it went on Pat Quinn's news feed. Pat saw it, immediately called Pete and said, Pete, I think we've got it. So what did Pat and Pete do that was so different? Pete and Pat got purposeful and strategic. They said, we're going to make this our own. So Pete called us in and with his eyes typed out, okay, this is what you're going to start seeing. People are going to start pouring ice water over their heads. What, Pete? People are going to start pouring buckets of ice over their head, and they're going to challenge three people. And this is what I want you and Dad to do. Every time someone does this, I want you to like, comment, share, and tag the post. Okay, now Pete, we're 15 years old, and you want us to do what? Okay, like, I got it. I know how to like, right? Comment, I know how to do like happy birthday. Share, okay, hit the share button, that'll go somewhere, okay. Tag, no idea what that means. Okay, so my son Andrew gave us, my husband and I, a little education in how to work the world of Facebook. And that's what we did. My husband and I manned our computers as Pete was purposefully emailing people. So this is what happened in those first couple of days. We were liking, sharing, commenting, and tagging. And Pete said, when you tag or when you comment, if you know that person may be mutual friends with someone of influence, meaning someone with a large number of followers, make sure you tag them in the comments so it will go on their newsfeed. At the same time, Pete wasn't working social media. He was actually reaching out to people that he knew who were people of influence. So one of his buddies is Matt Ryan. He had gone to Boston College with the Atlanta Falcons quarterback. He didn't write to Matt. He didn't just send it to him. He didn't just challenge him. What he did is he wrote an email to his wife, Sarah, who also went to BC with them. Said, Sarah, this is what's going on. Do you think you can get Matt to do it? Tell him my story, which he already knew, and tell him he can help tremendously if this is what he does. Matt Ryan, the quarterback of the Atlanta Falcons, did the Ice Bucket Challenge on day two or day three. But in the meantime, Team Freight Train, we had about 3,500 followers on Facebook by that point. They just exploded it. By day three, we had our sister-in-laws and brother-in-laws all around the kitchen table with us. We're all liking, sharing, commenting. We were still in our pajamas at 4 o'clock in the afternoon. And finally, someone's like, okay, who's gonna go in there and tell me we can't do this anymore? Because it had just exploded. And when I tell you that this was so fast that it even caught us off, we didn't even have time to think. Because within hours, it was spreading. We could see it spreading like wildfire, hours to hours. So the first week was Boston. The Ice Bucket Challenge started in Boston on a Thursday. We had Channel 5 at our door on Tuesday. Channel 7 Fox Channel 4 on Wednesday. We had the Globe, the Herald on Thursday. And by the second week, we had GMA. We had national news all coming to our house. Now, what was going on in August of 2014? As I told you, Pete was unfortunately pretty disabled. But at the same time, that girlfriend of his, Pete married a year later on June 1st, 2013. And in August of 2014, Julie was due with their baby in September. So when the national news started calling and wanted us to go to the local studio, we were saying, nope, sorry, we can't go. If you want to talk to us, you have to come here. And we live on a cul-de-sac, so CBS would come in, they'd finish, they'd go around the cul-de-sac and go out, and then NBC would come in, and we would just sit there, and they'd all come in with all their lights and everything, and we would just do interview after interview. Our first reaction, though, was don't give anybody our cell phone numbers, don't give anybody our emails. And then we thought about it, and we said, you know what? This is our time. When opportunity arises, you have to take hold of it, and you have to move very quickly and not let it bypass you. So we knew we were not going to let it bypass us. The third week were entertainment channels, because the third week Justin Timberlake had done it, and Justin Bieber, and then it's really started to hit A-list celebrities. Jimmy Fallon did it on The Tonight Show, and it really was gaining a lot of speed. So Entertainment Tonight was calling our house, Us Weekly, all these different publications. And then in the fourth week, Global. We did Irish radio, we did Japanese television, we did Australian Today Show. We were doing more interviews in more sections of the globe than you can even imagine. But we never rested, never thought this is too much, because we knew that we had to keep our pedal to the metal, because this was the time. So this is some of the traditional media that we were triaging while Pete and Andrew were doing social media and the rest of the family. The next video I want to show you is one that was done to show the movement of the Ice Bucket Challenge. I think it's a really enjoyable video to watch. Powerful when you look at it like that, when you see on, you know, day 13 that it's already in the Philippines. Just shows the speed that this went through the globe. Now, the number one reason people gave for doing the ALS Ice Bucket Challenge was that because someone they knew asked them to. The number one reason that they didn't do the Ice Bucket Challenge was because no one asked them to. The thing about the Ice Bucket Challenge, people want to make it about entertaining videos, but it was all based in personal relationships. It was people to people. It wasn't social media. Social media was the vehicle by which it propelled, but it was when people asked other people to do it. And those comments that Pete wanted us to write on people's Ice Bucket Challenge videos, he wanted us to thank people. He wanted us to show gratitude that people were joining our cause, that we knew that they were taking time out of their day to think about us and to help propel this movement into the global nature that it was. So the numbers are staggering. The money is unbelievable. But what I'd like to talk about now are the intangibles, because this movement really had such a profound effect in so many different ways. ALS awareness is at an all-time high, has never been where it is now. The ripple effect from August 2014, our traditional fundraising activities of galas and auctions and walks and runs, we're seeing somewhere between a 100 and 200% increase in participation in those areas. Collaboration. One of the things that Pete found entirely unacceptable when he was in this disease community was that the organizations that were involved in this community were operating in silos and not collaborating with each other. Well, we know together you can achieve more. Isn't that what a team does? Well, Pete made sure that after the Ice Bucket Challenge, that these organizations that had been the beneficiary of him and Pat got together in one room to work together towards finding a cure for that, for this disease. Public consciousness. We know we're top of mind right now. That if you say ALS, nobody's asking you, well, what is that? Or I heard something about a baseball player about that. New talent. I believe this is probably one of the biggest intangibles, that we're attracting new talent in this field. An example of this, the Mass General Hospital ALS Clinic hires one medical student every year as an intern. They usually get between 12 and 15 applications. In 2015, they received over 100 applications for that one spot, which means that even the medical students are looking at being ALS as what their concentration might be. And Dr. Merritt, that we're very close to, I remember when she told me that stat, she looked at me and she said, Nancy, 3 years ago, ALS didn't have Pete Frates. Early diagnosis. We know through those Wikipedia hits and that Google search that a lot of primary care doctors probably went to Google to find out what's this disease everybody's pouring ice water over their head. Because we know if they don't go in the track of neurology, ALS is basically a paragraph in their medical textbook. And so we do know, based on referrals to ALS clinics throughout the United States, that primary care physicians are more acutely aware of an ALS early signs. Now, early diagnosis is so phenomenal for the patient because clinical trials, you have to fit certain parameters. And the earlier you can get a diagnosis, the earlier you have the likelihood of getting into an experimental drug. But it's also good for the whole community because we know as we track progression in ALS patients, their progression can vary from one patient to the next. That's another one of the mysteries of this disease. But if they can get patients early, they can track the data. The clinicians are all about data, and they can track this data, and they might be able to use it more effectively in finding a treatment for the disease. So the early diagnosis is a major player in trying to get to the finish line here. Energy. There has never been energy in the ALS community and it even is to today, there are more patients just out there talking about their disease than ever before. The researchers have renewed energy. The neurologists that have been working this disease for 40 years, they've said to us, this is the game changer. Everybody is on board with this. And probably the most amazing, intangible, is the hope. There is now such hope in the community that we can see the finish line, that we're going to get a treatment for this disease. And the doctors now are saying that they believe that it probably is going to happen within the next 5 years. They will have some effective treatment to slow this disease down. Because if you ask family members, they just want it to stop. We just want to stop. Because honestly, over the last 4 years, every morning I would wake up and I didn't know what part of Pete I was going to grieve that day. Might have been the day he could no longer hold a pencil in his hand, or a cup in his hand, or be able to raise his hand, to be able to walk, talk, eat, breathe. To the family and the village around the patient, there is now new hope. And one thing that I've been told by Dr. Bob Brown, he said, Nancy, unfortunately, in the diagnosis, it's still factually the same. It's still you have ALS, no treatment, no cure, and 2 to 5 year prognosis. He said, but then there's a change, and they look at us, and they'll say, this is the ice bucket challenge disease. And there's hope, because they know that people now know what their disease is, and they know that there are people fighting, and there are people donating, and that there is huge faith in that we're going to pass this finish line. And the lessons. What are the lessons that we have to share from this journey? Well, the first thing is, how do you wake up in the morning? I don't think anybody would blame our family if when we woke up in the morning, we would pull the covers over our head and feel really bad about the situation that we've been handed. But we don't do that. We wake up every morning and we choose to live positively and proactively. We know from that night that Pete gave us our directive that we had to wake up and face the day and face what we had been handed and to work to help change the situation. Kindness. What do they say about kindness? When you throw kindness out, all of it eventually will come back to you. Well, that's exactly what happened with Pete and Pat and Steve Gleason. These are men who lived good lives and were kind in their leadership and their friendship. All that kindness came back to them. And it's that kindness that helped change the world. Respect. Boy, this is something that all of us really need to take a big breath and think about. You have to respect other people because you never, ever know what's going on in their lives. Why they might be curt to you that day, or why they might not be talking. You just don't know. An example of this is in Pete's first year of diagnosis, he was barely in a wheelchair. He could still walk with assistance. And one of the things that he loved to do, as I said, was to go on boats. And he would always, and his friends would go down to Nantucket for the big game fishing tournament. And we all went down because, of course, Pete had been diagnosed and we wanted to make sure that everything was okay with him and his crew. And my husband and I were sitting on the dock and the boat was in front of us. And Pete and Julie had showed up, but Pete needed assistance walking down to the boat. So his two friends had him on either side. And as he was walking, these people were walking by us, between us and Pete. And all of a sudden, I heard the wife turn to the husband and say, oh, look at that boy already completely drunk at 12 noon. And I just thought to myself, boy, if you just don't be so judgmental and understand. Now it's, look, I don't blame her. You couldn't misinterpret that. But I do believe that we all need to understand that sometimes things just aren't as face value, that people have other things going on in their lives, and we need to respect everyone. Gratitude. Ask anyone who has faced a challenge in their life. This is probably one of the blessings that come out of something like this. We live now a life full of gratitude. We live every day to the fullest. Just grateful that we have this day to live. Just grateful that we have Pete. Even though a lot has been taken from him, he's still there. He still smiles at us. His spirit, his essence, is with us every day. Make sure that we live a life of cliches, right? That's what we live now. Stop and smell the roses. Our life changed in a minute. All those things are cliches because they're true. When life throws you a curveball, that's when you know that every moment is so very precious. That life is not a dress rehearsal. That the 5 minutes that I just had, I'm never gonna get back. So be grateful for just waking up in the morning and putting your 2 feet on the ground and being able to live in this beautiful world that we've been given. Unacceptable situations. That's what we found ourselves in. And what I say to you is if you find yourself in a situation that you deem so unacceptable, I say you dig down really deep and you act like a mother bear who finds an unacceptable situation and work as hard as you can to help right the ship, not whine about the ship. Goodness, there's one thing the ALS Ice Bucket Challenge proved, is that people are innately good. Every day, we are faced with the most horrific news on our television cameras of all the bad things that people do in life. Well, the historic August 2014 shows that you give people an opportunity to do something good for someone else, they will. Friendships. Friendships, hold them dear. Don't have fleeting friendships. Love those that love you and be there for them when life takes a turn. Community. The strength of a community can change the world. The power of our community is so strong, it really propels us every day. And when I say community, I mean Boston. The Boston community, our community of Beverly, Massachusetts, they have been behind us since day one. They promote every single thing that we do because they know that people are now vested in our story. So, what's happening now? What is going on? So the first thing is, since the ALS Ice Bucket Challenge, we've actually had some discoveries which are directly credited back to the Ice Bucket Challenge. Johns Hopkins researchers, they have an ALS clinic down there, they came out in August of 2015 and said a protein, it's called TDP43, they identified this protein 10 years ago. They knew that it was a negative protein that attacked the motor neurons, but they couldn't find it. And the researchers came out and said, because of the money that was risen, that they got from the Ice Bucket Challenge, they took risks in the lab that they normally wouldn't. Because you see, in medical research, every penny has to be accounted for, either grants or from a donor. They don't take risks often because people don't want their money wasted. But what they said the Ice Bucket Challenge did is it allowed them to take the risks that made them discover the protein 3 to 4 years before they were on track to find it. So now that they've identified this protein, they can start finding the antigen for it and hopefully develop a drug that will help stop the negativity of this protein. The ALS-TDI, which is a research center strictly for ALS in Cambridge, Massachusetts, they raised enough money. They raised about $4 million. They had a precision medicine program where they were collecting DNA samples from ALS patients. They were only supposed to have 40 people in it, but they took the money raised from the Ice Bucket Challenge and they've now enrolled 300 people. So the greater the data set, the better the data will be coming out of it. So it allowed them to do that, to find more discoveries. We have a new hashtag. After the Ice Bucket Challenge, everybody was asking us, are you gonna do it again? When are you gonna do it again? And frankly, why are you gonna do it again? So we came up with a five-word hashtag, every August until a cure, pretty much answers all those questions. And what's surprising is sometimes when people see that, they're like, you mean you don't have a cure for that after all the money you guys raised? We have strategic business partners now. Major League Baseball finally came a calling. They are now strategic partners with us in the fight against ALS. The NFL, Facebook are all working with the ALS community. The entertainment industry. I don't know if any of you saw the first season of the Fox show Empire that came out, which was a pretty high profile series that was on Fox. That whole plot was written about a family with a patriarch who ran a music empire. And the first episode, the patriarch was given the diagnosis of ALS. I can guarantee you before August 2014, it wouldn't have been ALS that he would have been given. Collaboration. Patients in our community have risen up and demanded collaboration. So we have new organizations fighting for different parts of our disease community. And our family. Oh, that little girl that was born, that's my granddaughter Lucy and Julie. And this is my extended family. We now have three granddaughters, Addie, Freya, and Lucy. And the reason I played Pharrell Happy is that's Lucy's favorite song, so I need to play that. But the little spiritual story here, as I said, Julie was due in September of 2014 with their first child, and of course, August 2014 came along. Well, on August 31st, 2 weeks early, little Lucy decided to be born as the exclamation point to the miraculous month of 2014. Lucy's birthday is August 31st, 2014. And we've also had a lot of fun along the way. So I just want to show you a couple of videos about the fun that we've had along the way and what community has done for us. So this is Pete's 30th birthday on December 28th, 2015. 2014.
Estimated that more than 10 million people took this challenge.
This was on the Jumbotron at Patriots Stadium.
Globally, including over 115 million directly to the ALS Association in Washington. Earlier this month, Pete was recognized by Sports Illustrated as their inspiration of the year, and he even inspired the Patriots to accept the challenge.
John had just initiated this with Coach Bell.
I love showing this one. I'm in Massachusetts.
Here in New England, we're about team. So on three, one, two, three.
So So 68,000 people sang happy birthday to Pete on his 30th birthday. And I have to tell you, I did not go to that game. I did not know that was gonna happen. So I was home by myself while the rest of the family was there. But it was very profound for me to be there, not to be there, to watch it on TV, because when they told me Pete only had 2 to 5 years to live and he was 27, the first thing I said to the doctor was, he deserves to see his 30th birthday. So he had it in a pretty, celebrated in a pretty great way. And then Major League Baseball finally called on Pete. And of course it was our beloved Boston Red Sox that called Pete and said, Pete, Major League Baseball really wants you. This was opening day, 2015.
And now Red Sox General Manager Ben Cherington will make a dream come true. He will make official Pete's membership forever in the family of the Boston Red Sox by signing this good player and this good man to a professional baseball contract.
So Pete is now a member of the Boston Red Sox.
Welcome to the Boston Red Sox.
You know, he was pretty upset when he wasn't drafted. I think this is even better. So, over the last 3 years, I've been trying to articulate exactly why, how our family has done this. And I have to tell you, I really struggled with the words until last summer. Sheryl Sandberg, who is the one of the executives at Facebook, lost her husband tragically at age 47. And she wrote a beautiful blog in on Facebook. And it was the second to the last paragraph that really was very profound to me. 30 days after her husband died, her daughter was to go to a father-daughter dance. And his best friend came over to bring her. And she said, she looked right at him and she said, Dave should be going to this. Dave is the one that should be taking her to this dance. And the friend looked at her and said, Cheryl, I'm sorry, but option A is no longer available. So we're gonna kick the shit out of option B. Principal, I apologize for using the language, but it is pretty profound in my world because we go back to our lives any day prior to March 13, 2012, but we can't. We've been handed this, and this is what we do every day. Pete's 31st birthday this year was another celebration, and his friends got together and made a birthday video for him. So the Boston Red Sox, Sam Kennedy, the new Red Sox president, his friend Matt Ryan wishing him. And I'm not gonna play this all through, but the end of it is the commissioner of Major League Baseball. He says right in his birthday note to Pete that Major League Baseball is committed to helping end ALS. And I am happy to share with you that I've been in New York at the offices of Major League Baseball putting together a strategy for the 2016 season. So you'll be seeing ALS in Major League parks this year, which is really unbelievable. So again, every morning when we wake up, we choose to live the day in positivity. And we use an affirmation that Pete used to use to all his coworkers and teammates. Be passionate, be genuine, be hardworking, and don't ever be afraid to be great. Words to live by. I'd like to end my presentation with a short video. Every year on Pete's birthday, we plunge into the Atlantic Ocean up in Gloucester, Massachusetts, in the Plunge for Pete, which you saw in the news video that I started with. This is a video made from this year's plunge, but Pete narrates it, and I'd like to share it with you right now.
than salt water, swamp, deers, or the sea. Hundreds of people jumping into the sea in winter will test the credibility of this quote from Isaac Dinesen. I have ALS and ALS has no cure and there is no treatment. These people plunging into the frigid water is my treatment. Millions of people around the world dumping water and ice over their heads is my treatment.
Feel your presence in your absence, shut the door.
Awareness of this horrific disease, my mission, and without your help, ALS would not be at the forefront of national news. Hundreds of millions of dollars would not have been raised to help find the treatment or a cure.
Unforgettable
stories and stories. We may not know as much, but you know what we smile. The year's number is worth $114
billion.
Your sweat and tears are very much appreciated, and I thank you.
Thank you for having me here tonight. And thank you from the Freedies family. So, does anybody have any questions that if anyone has anything they'd like to ask about any part of it? No? Well, I know that they have a lovely dessert, and my daughter and I will be around for a little bit, but thanks to Danny's Place and the United Way and the PTSO, I'm an old PTSO parent, president, I had elementary, middle, high school. Thank you for having us, and thank you for allowing me to share the story.
Very quickly, I do want to join Joanne and Susan's comments before Nancy spoke in thanking Nancy for a couple things. One is certainly for sharing her family's amazing story, for sharing Pete with us as well, and also for me, just the lessons that you learn. I certainly still remember that August and seeing all the videos on our Facebook team. So to hear about sort of the backstory and the work involved and the inspiration involved is a wonderful way to spend this evening. At this point, we had plans for a few of us to have the privilege of becoming a small part of this amazing story with our own little version of the ice bucket, so that's why you've got the kiddie pool over there. As Joanne mentioned, she was originally going to be part of this live moment, but understandably, there's been some bugs going around. I don't know if anybody has experienced it, and so it makes sense for, instead of the live version, I think we have a video of when you and Quinn did it. Brendan, are you up there? Yep, you're up there. So, A, to show it, and B, to stall for a little longer before I get soaking wet, we're going to show the video.
So, Quinn and I have accepted the ALS
Facebook Challenge.
And I'm over the 24-hour limit, so I've donated $100 to ALS Research. And I want to challenge Michelle Wilbur, Raina Schiffer, Liz Gordon, and the entire Stege family from across the pond, Tracy, Ryan, Kurt and Cindy Stege, and their kids, And Quinn wants to challenge.
As Ryan mentioned, Jane, and then Beth Baker, Associate Principal, and yours truly. And I think we have a bucket of, that's got some names of people who submitted their names, so we're actually going to do something where instead of dumping on ourselves, we're going to give people the chance to help us out with it. I am wondering, hopefully whoever gets selected for me is a little taller than 6'3", and we'll see how that works. But Jane, would you like to go first, or does that work for you? Pushing it as far and long as possible. All right, hopefully I'm pronouncing this name right. Aiden Mufsky, am I pronouncing it right, Aiden? All right, Aiden, why don't you come up? We're gonna figure out how this works. Miss Baker, are you ready? Nick Giasonia, are you still here? Eighth grader at RJ Gray Junior High School, whose principal is Ann Shaw. Outside. I don't know if Nancy, you're still out there, but I'm sure some people would love to thank you and say hello out there. So thank you everyone for spending the evening with us. We hope you found it worthwhile and see you again.